Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the COVID-19 2022. We've received apologies this morning from Alex Rowley, MSP, and we are joined by Jackie Bailey, MSP, who is attending as a committee substitute. I welcome you to the meeting and invite you to declare any relevant interest. Mrs. Bailey. Jackie Bailey, do you have any relevant interest?
Thank you, Convener. I wasn't unmuted at the time, but I now am. There are no relevant.
Thank you, Mrs. Bailey. Brian Whittle, as a committee member, is running slightly late and he will be joining us later on this morning. This morning we'll be taking evidence from the Scottish Government on the latest ministerial statement on COVID-19. Subordinate legislation and other matters noted in the agenda. I'd like to welcome to the meeting John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, Penelope Cooper, Director of COVID Coordination, and Elizabeth Blair, COVID Coordination for the Scottish Government. Thank you for your attendance this morning. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move on to questions?
Thank you, Convener. I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to discuss a number of matters, including updates to Parliament on COVID-19, and I'll make a brief opening statement. As set out by the First Minister on Tuesday, while Omicron continues to cause high levels of cases and we must maintain proportionate protective measures, the data we are seeing gives us confidence that we've turned the corner on the Omicron wave. Although cases remain high, we are continuing to see a reduction in cases across most age groups. Admissions to hospital of people with COVID, although still too high, are now falling. The success of our vaccination programme, the willingness of the public to adapt their behaviour, and the temporary protective measures introduced in December have all helped to limit the impact of the Omicron wave. This is positive news, but given how infectious Omicron is and the impact that it is having on our society, we must remain careful and cautious as we continue to lift additional protective measures in a phased approach. First Minister confirmed that from Monday the 24th of January, the remaining statutory measures introduced in response to Omicron will be lifted. These include the requirement for table service in certain hospitality settings and the closure of nightclubs. Non-professional indoor contact sports can also resume from Monday. While it remains sensible to stay cautious in our social interactions and prioritise who we meet, the First Minister also confirmed that guidance asking people to limit indoor gatherings to three households will be lifted. Our advice remains to take a lateral flow test and report the result whenever meeting others. Reporting test results, including when negative, will ensure that we are able to make better assessments of the trends in infection. Certification will remain in place for events and venues previously covered by the scheme, and we are asking event organisers to check the certification status of more people attending events. Cabinet agreed this week not to extend the COVID certification scheme given the improving situation. For the time being, baseline measures such as wearing face coverings in indoor places and working from home wherever possible will remain in place. The requirement for businesses, service providers and places of worship to take reasonable measures to minimise the spread of COVID on their premises will be retained at this stage to help keep COVID contained as this wave recedes. The vaccination programme continues, and I would encourage anyone who has not yet had their first, second or booster dose to do so as soon as possible. Getting fully vaccinated is the most important thing we can do just now to protect ourselves and each other. First Minister noted on Tuesday we are entering a calmer phase of the epidemic. This will allow us to consider the adaptations that we might need to make to build our resilience and manage the virus in a less restrictive way in the future as we move into an endemic phase. However, we have not yet reached the endemic phase and we must remain cautious given the uncertainties that lie ahead. I'm very happy to answer any questions the committee may have.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. We are short of time, so I'm going to ask that questions and answers be as concise as possible. If I could just ask a question first. Thankfully, Omicron is now on the decrease, although we're cautiously aware that in the future there could be new variants. With variant surveillance, how is the integrity of surveillance for new variants being maintained, given that the PCR tests will not always be required now, and by people getting a positive lateral flow test?
Professor Jason Leach to provide some of the epidemiological information in this respect, but quite clearly there is a huge amount of surveillance data that is available, still remains available to government. There are still substantial numbers of PCR tests being undertaken. There are wider studies that are undertaken, and then of course there is the exchange of scientific information around across a number of jurisdictions to enable us to create a commanding picture of the information that's been available to us. Obviously, the detection of the Omicron wave was made much more practical by the correlation with the S gene dropout failure element of assessment, which was undertaken. And of course, there will be a range of scientific interventions that we can make to ensure this remains the case. But Professor Leach will provide proper detail.
Morning, convener. Morning, convener. Morning, everybody else. This is a global problem and not something Scotland can solve alone. Let's think about how we discovered Omicron. We discovered Omicron because there was a large outbreak in a region of South Africa that looked different from other outbreaks, seemed to be transmitting very quickly. It then went to Hong Kong, and Hong Kong's genetic sequencing found a variant that looked more transmissible. Back to South Africa, genetic sequencing in South Africa confirmed that pattern, and then the WHO announced it to the world. So this, the discovery of variants is not a Scottish problem, it is a WHO problem. And they have a surveillance problem and solution around the whole world. So South Africa has some of the best genetic sequencing in the world, so does Scotland, and we will continue to do that on behalf of the world. So finding it is the first challenge, then monitoring it once you know it exists is your second challenge, and that's what we managed to do with S gene target failure, and we would do again. Remember, we still have quite a lot of PCRs. We have PCRs from every hospital case, PCRs from every symptomatic case who turns up, and we have PCRs from the ONS survey. So we still have quite a lot of PCR testing, which can then proportionately go for genetic sequencing. So I'm very comfortable we can still sequence enough to find what's happening. My final point here is there are thousands of variants, thousands. It changes every day. So what matters is there a variant that is causing a new challenge, transmission, serious disease, whatever that might be. And that requires real-time data of monitoring the number of cases you have, the number of hospitalizations you have. That could be in Scotland. It proportionately, and by luck, it's more likely to be in another country, but it could be here, but it's more likely to be somewhere else. So we have to do this globally, not just in Scotland. But I'm comfortable with our own surveillance system, but I would just put a proviso on that we need the whole world to be able to do that.
Thanks very much for those answers. Just one quick question. As we are encouraging, well, there are a lot of isolation with the new Omicron variant and being encouraged just to do a lateral flow test and not get a CPR and just self-isolate for the time amount. For the people that have been told to self-isolate but not get a PCR test and then try to get the self-isolation grant from the local authority, I've had constituents this week being told that they're not eligible because they need a negative PCR test and the lateral flow test isn't enough for them. How are we with this gap between people that are testing positive and then need to get a grant, just being able to tie up between the lateral flow test and the PCRs?
There shouldn't be an issue there, convener. Obviously, individuals who are required to self-isolate, which will be the case if an individual tests negative in a lateral flow device test, they should be eligible for self-isolation grant support. Obviously, if there's an issue with that, then I will look into it carefully with local authorities to make sure that people who require self-isolation grant support are able to obtain that, given the requirement for them to self-isolate in terms of the arrangements we now have in place.
That's great. That's very helpful. Thanks very much. I'll move on to the next question. Can I bring in Murdo Fraser, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and colleagues. I've got two questions, and given we're short of time, I'll just ask them both together if I can. Firstly, Cabinet Secretary, you said a moment ago that the Scottish Government's view was that COVID had not yet reached endemic status in the Scottish population. Do you have any modelling or projections as to when you think that will happen? And my second question is around the impact of Omicron. We have, as you said, seen a very high number of cases, but we're now seeing hospitalisations tailed off. If we cast our minds back to where we were in December, we were being advised in the committee that, you know, Omicron could see thousands of additional deaths. Unfortunately, we've not seen anything like that impact. Given that we're likely to see more variants coming of COVID, is there a risk that if that happens, the public will say experts and advisors have been crying wolf over the impact of Omicron, and therefore will be resistant to measures taken in trying to safeguard the population, because the experience of Omicron has been nothing like as serious as was originally being forecast?
I'll ask Professor Leach to deal in a moment with the question of epidemic and endemic, because there's a, you know, very clear scientific basis of judgment that has to be applied in that question, and it's appropriate that he provides the committee with that advice. On the second part of Mr. Fraser's question, the one point of detail that I think I would probably part company with Mr. Fraser about in his analysis is that from my recollection, I don't think the projection or the suggestion was made that Omicron was going to lead to a significantly greater number of deaths. I think the fear of Omicron was that the huge volume of cases would give rise to a very large volume of hospitalisation, which would place a burden on the National Health Service, because we recognised that in the emerging evidence from South Africa, it appeared that Omicron, although generally a milder version by comparison to Delta, would still give rise to a sizeable number of cases within the population, which would result in hospitalisation. What I would contend is that the combination of the measures that the government put in place, the response of members of the public, change in behaviours that took place in the run-up to Christmas, essentially enabled us to flatten the Omicron curve. And we have had, if we look at the numbers, the numbers of cases were of such a magnitude that in previous variants would have led to much more acute measures being taken. You know, the levels of cases were much, much higher than the number of cases that resulted in the lockdown the 4th of January 2021. But obviously, so that position materialised, but obviously the combination of the vaccine strategy, the measures, restrictions put in place by government, and the change in public behaviour and participation enabled us to flatten the worst effects. But we still have, and I think we've got to be really careful about this point, we still have huge demands on the National Health Service as a consequence of Omicron. You know, we have over 1,500 patients in hospital with COVID just now, which is a very high number, putting acute pressure on the National Health Service.
Can I bring in Jason Leach, please?
Yeah, briefly on question two, if you'll allow me, then I'll do the endemic one. The advice at the beginning of Omicron was that we simply didn't know if the, let's call them, rumours of slightly milder disease were true or not. No, nobody knew. But we did know pretty quickly that booster doses of vaccines were crucial. And that's why we were able to vaccinate at one point the fastest of any country in the world. So protections, human behaviour and vaccination is why the Omicron wave is not as damaging as it was, with a contribution from the virus that in the end is milder than the Delta version of the virus. Now, unpicking how much is virus and how much is vaccination will take months. But all of those things together is why we haven't seen the absolute worst that we thought Omicron might be. And that's a credit to the National Health Service vaccination teams and to the public who reduced their contacts appropriately, partly because we told them to and partly because it was voluntary. Endemic, I think, is a little misunderstood. The disease that everybody suggests is endemic is flu. Endemicity is about predictability. So it is defined as a disease that is in an area of the world that is relatively predictable. So you know when it's coming, you know what it's going to do. It doesn't say anything about severity. Malaria is an endemic disease and kills 600,000 people a year. Not here, but in the billions of people who catch it in sub-Saharan Africa and Southeast Asia. So endemicity is not about ease. It's not about making it better. It's about predictability. Now, for now, COVID is unpredictable. We don't know when the next wave is coming. We don't know whether it will be better or worse than the previous wave. So the WHO will decide when this disease becomes endemic. Because just now, the WHO say it is a pandemic. And the definition of that is every single person on Earth is at risk of it. So when they decide that it's more predictable, which I hope will happen in 2022, but nobody knows if it will happen in 2022. Now, how Scotland and other countries, of course, choose to deal with the next year of the pandemic is actually the core of your question. So what do we do as this disease moves into another year of being a pandemic, and how should we react to it? And that's, I think, what this committee has been asking and the government has been trying to respond to throughout this whole period. But I'm not sure it's a pandemic versus endemic intellectual conversation. It's about how we manage our pandemic, which of course has global implications, just like we've discussed around genetic sequencing, but also has implications for our strategic framework, which we're refreshing, which the government will announce in the next 2 weeks.
Thank you. Can I bring in Jackie Bailey now?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Deputy First Minister and his officials. He'll be aware that the Scottish Government stopped fertility treatment for those women who weren't fully vaccinated. This was done the day before Christmas Eve. No notice was given. And then I understand the Scottish Government extended it on the 7th of January to include treatments in the private sector as well. I'm sure you can imagine that the women who were preparing for treatment in early January were frankly distraught. The emotional turmoil they went through was considerable. And in some cases, women were indeed vaccinated, but because they caught COVID, they couldn't get their booster in time and their treatment was cancelled too. So there was a real feeling that the lack of an individual approach and this blanket ban was not fair on many of the women involved. Other women have since been in touch, genuinely confused, because the advice from health professionals at the very start of the COVID pandemic was that pregnant women, or indeed those expecting to be pregnant within the next 3 months, should not be vaccinated. Of course, you and I know that both changed. However, it strikes me that there is genuine confusion. So I have three questions. One, can we get clinicians to explain to those women who are undergoing fertility treatment how the guidance has changed and to provide reassurance to them, because currently there is confusion? Two, as cases are starting to decline now, when will the service be resumed and will it be conditional? And thirdly, will women caught up in this and affected by this actually get an extra cycle of IVF to make up for what's been lost? Thank you.
Convener, I recognise the significance and the sensitivity of the points that Jackie Bailey is raising with me this morning. And look, I'll draw an input from Professor Leach in addition to what I say, but let me try to provide some reassurance here. The advice that emerged from clinicians, and I stress it was clinical advice that led to the decisions to pause fertility treatment, was based on, certainly from my reading, overwhelming evidence that indicated that the necessity of vaccination whilst pregnant was critical in those circumstances. And this is based, I don't have all the detail in front of me, but there was research undertaken on the number of, or the proportion of pregnant women who were admitted to critical care as a consequence of COVID. And from my recollection, well over 90% of those cases were amongst women who were unvaccinated. So the clinical evidence was overwhelming in this respect, which led to the pause being applied. Now, I quite recognise the distress and upset that would cause to individuals affected. There certainly should be good explanation of the rationale, because having looked at this material before, as I have done, I've seen very clear and very well expressed clinical opinion and evidence on this subject. So that should be shared with individuals in all circumstances. And the second point that Jackie Bailey raised with me in terms of the resumption of clinical care, the resumption of fertility treatment, that will happen as soon as we are in a position to do so, when the vaccination programme has delivered the degree of protection that we consider necessary in the context of the Omicron wave. And lastly, and on this point, I will seek clarification from Jason Leach, but I think the government has made clear that there will be no disadvantage to any women who may have been going through fertility treatment, that they will in any way lose out on an opportunity to pursue that fertility treatment because of the pause in arrangements that have been put in place. But I'd be grateful for Professor Leach's input on that question as well.
Thanks, Deputy First Minister and Ms Bailey. So the third one is the easiest. There will be no disadvantage to couples who have had to have their IVF treatment paused. So there will be an extension of the time and, if necessary, an extension of the cycles, depending on where they were in the cycles when this clinically based decision was made. It was awkward timing, of course. Clinical decisions often are, because clinical decisions don't know the calendar. It was completely risk-based. So it was about the safety of women and babies. And the decision was made not lightly, but very, very hard because of the nature of this disease and the nature of what it does, in particular to high-risk individuals. And high-risk individuals, I'm afraid, includes pregnant women, IVF or not. So those individual cases should be having individual conversations with their care teams in the fertility units around the country, whether they are public or private. I have done some of that at a national level, both in the media and in stakeholder groups, but I can't have individual conversations with each couple, and it would be inappropriate. So those individual conversations should be having being had with their individual case leaders. And they certainly have the information because the advice came from many of those clinicians. The second part of your question is the hardest, about when would we restart. This is not about case rates. It's about risk of COVID if you're pregnant. So that risk of COVID if you're pregnant will remain whatever the case rate is. The way to restart is to get vaccinated. We know that vaccinated pregnant women are much safer than unvaccinated pregnant women. Your point about vaccination at the very beginning of the pandemic, for what was literally a few weeks of advice, was all about the fact that we hadn't vaccinated pregnant women. So therefore, the research couldn't be done because we couldn't say, this is what you should do if you're pregnant, because we hadn't vaccinated pregnant women in the research trials. So it was just a precautionary measure to say, while we are doing the rest of the research in pregnant women and in kidney transplant patients, and we have to tell you not to have your vaccine yet. But as soon as the pregnant women trials were done and it was proved safe, we told pregnant women to get their vaccine. I understand why that might be confusing to some, but pregnant women have now been vaccinated in their hundreds of thousands around the world safely. And that's what we've been doing in Scotland for a long time. So the way to restart your IVF is to get vaccinated.
Thank you. I'll move on to John Mason. If we do have time at the end, I will come back to members for supplementary questions. John Mason, please.
Thank you very much, convener. In yesterday's Herald newspaper, there was a column by Stuart Patrick, who is executive of Glasgow Chamber of Commerce. He is arguing that this is the time to move within the four harms to kind of take direct health, give it less priority, and give more priority to other health, social and economic impacts. Obviously, he's particularly interested in the economic side. I just wonder how the Cabinet Secretary would respond to that.
The framework that we put in place in the summer of 2020, which is the four harms framework to which Mr. Mason refers, has, in my view, been an essential guide to the decision making that ministers have undertaken. It has enabled there to be a transparent and open conversation with the public, the range of interested parties, about the nature of the decisions that have had to be considered. At all times, you know, if I go back to March and April 2020, I would say that direct COVID health harms were exclusively determining the decision making that was being undertaken, because we were in such an acute moment of crisis. From the summer of 2020 onwards, we have struck a balance, sought to strike a balance across the four harms to try to ensure that, and this is reflected in the strategic purpose of the government's agenda, which is to try to manage the COVID pandemic in a way that enables people to appreciate and enjoy as many of the aspects of normal life as we can possibly do so. That, to me, remains the rational and considered approach that the government should take. I think if we disregard direct health harm, then before we know it, the health service will be overwhelmed. That would have been the case in December around Omicron. If the government had just ignored the direct health harm, then the health service would have been overwhelmed. I have no doubt about that at all in my mind. And the degree of health suffering, direct health suffering to members of the public, would have been much greater. I don't think there would have been many people in society would have thought that was a rational approach for the government to have taken. So the strategy that we have adopted has been to take difficult but evidenced and considered decisions on the balance of the four harms to protect public health, but to enable people to appreciate and to enjoy as much of normal life as we could hope to achieve in the context of a global pandemic.
Okay, thanks very much. I've got a second area I wanted to touch on. There was some coverage in the media yesterday about compulsory vaccinations. Specifically, it was about an offshore company, I think CNR, who are insisting that all their employees are vaccinated before they go offshore. So I just wonder what the government's current thinking on that is. I mean, obviously, you have no control over what an oil company might do, but are we relaxed about organisations insisting on vaccination? Because up till now, I don't think the NHS in Scotland is insisting on vaccination.
The government's position is that we will not mandate people to have vaccination. It is a voluntary programme, and that is the government's position. Obviously, if an individual organisation takes an approach of that nature, then it is obviously free to do so. But I would counsel that it needs to engage constructively with its employees on such questions, because the issues and approaches of that type will undoubtedly have an effect on who will be eligible and available for employment in such a context. And it is up to individual employers to come to undertake those discussions.
Okay, if I can have one final question, just a factual one. There's been talk about charging for the tests, LFT tests. Can you tell us what the cost of an LFT test is?
The last cost I saw was of the order of £3 per test, but I may stand to be corrected by one of my officials on that question.
That's my understanding too. I think you saw the same briefing as I. It was about £3 a test. That's a calculation from many hundreds of millions of tests divided by the cost. So I'm not sure it's entirely accurate, but it's about £3 ago.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much. Can I bring in Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just going to continue with some of the questions that we've discussed before, Cabinet Secretary. I was looking at instances of lung cancer over the piece, and the report back says that half of lung cancer diagnoses are being diagnosed at stage four, and during COVID there's been a 25% reduction in diagnosis and a 25% reduction in treatment. And they were asking that there should be a lung cancer screening program required specifically for over 50s and smokers. You know, understanding the balance that you're having to make, Cabinet Secretary, and decisions the government are having to make, where are we with consideration of those kind of statistics and gathering those kind of statistics and making decisions on that basis?
The data that is relevant here is, I would contend, clearly available, because Mr. Whittle has just recounted that data to me. So I think the collection of data enables us to see comparative levels of referrals for individual cancer treatments and for a variety of other treatments, the number of cases that will have been handled, and the period and the time at which they have materialised. Now, obviously, this is there has been a sustained effort that has been put into maintaining cancer services throughout the challenges of the pandemic. When other services were paused, cancer services were maintained. But I would have to acknowledge that individuals will have been more reluctant to come forward for wider health treatment during the pandemic, and the evidence and the data reinforces that point. I think what's important is that we reiterate the necessity for individuals to come forward for treatment of this type. Where they have concerns about their health, the National Health Service is open and available to deliver treatment to individuals. And I think it's important that at all stages individuals hear that message, and that the health service does all that it can to deliver on that. Now, obviously, the health service capacity to deliver in this respect depends on the degree to which we can suppress the impact of COVID on the health service. And obviously, the Omicron wave has essentially reinvigorated the number of patients in hospital with COVID. If we go back to a period just before Omicron, I think we were down at about 900 patients in hospital with COVID. We are now, I think it was lower than that, but we're now in excess of 1,500. So the necessity of suppressing the prevalence of COVID enables the health service to be able to devote more resources to addressing the type of conditions that Mr. Whittle fairly puts to me as being important to members of the public.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. But I think where I'm trying to I understand the balance and of a lot of different factors the government has to make. I think if we look at the number of people who are in hospital or who have tragically lost their life to COVID, it's usually because the predominance is with people with other issues as well as COVID, which COVID exacerbates that. I think Again, because this is the Recovery Committee, I'm trying to look ahead, and that it's really important that we don't lose sight of that particular fact, that those who are in hospital usually have some other issues. So it might seem a mute point here, Cabinet Secretary, but one of the other things I looked at, for example, was that Health Board's missing the smoking cessation targets through COVID, understandably through COVID. How do we balance that? How do we pull that back together? Because to me, you know, it's almost a chicken and egg situation here. If we could reduce causing significant health impacts by treating other issues, then perhaps we could reduce the impact of COVID itself. How does the government balance, make those decisions and balance those things out?
Essentially, that is reconciled through the Four Harms framework that I discussed in my earlier answers with John Mason. Because what the, you know, and simply remind the committee of these details, the government has assessed the relationship between direct health harm from COVID and although Mr. Whittle is correct, some people will have lost their lives to COVID with other conditions, but other people have lost their lives because of COVID directly. There is then non-COVID health harm, economic and social harms. The government essentially has been trying to enable people to be able to experience as much of normal life as we can hope for whilst we wrestle with a global pandemic. So that has a bearing on the extent and the nature of health treatments that are available and can be delivered. Now, on all of the preventative health interventions that the government supports, for example, the smoking cessation programme Mr. Whittle puts to me, these all need to be part and parcel of what we argue and put forward to members of the public as vital elements of the health protection that individuals need to pursue to lead a healthy life. And that should be sustained during COVID, and any treatment as a consequence of that needs to be sustained in that context as well. So I think it's important that we focus on these additional health harms different from COVID, but inevitably, and I think this is the hard reality of all of this, the capacity of the National Health Service to address those issues will be greatly enhanced if we can see a lesser impact on the health service as a consequence of COVID.
Thank you. Can I bring in Jim Fairley now, please?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Convener. I've got two questions. One's a very narrow one, which will probably direct to you. Deputy First Minister, we're seeing lots of reports in the newspapers this morning that the Scottish Government are now coming under pressure because of something that the English Government have done in removing the requirement for face masks in schools. And I find that quite frustrating, that because England has done it, that Scotland then seems to be asking to follow on. Can I ask you what the Scottish Government's position is in terms of face masks in schools? And also the second question, in the interest of time, it's about medical exemptions. I understand that there are four categories of medical exemption, but for someone who has an underlying health risk, would anxiety about their underlying health be considered part of an exemption right for them not to be vaccinated? Not that I'm advocating that they don't get the vaccine, that's a specific constituent question. Thank you.
On Mr. Fairley's first point in relation to face coverings, the Scottish Government's position has not changed in the light of the announcements made by the Prime Minister yesterday, either in relation to the wearing of face coverings in crowded public places or on public transport, or in relation to schools. So there is absolutely no change in the Scottish Government's position, and Parliament was advised on Tuesday of the Government's position, and if there was to be any change in that position, Parliament would be advised. But as things stand just now, the Scottish Government is absolutely crystal clear that the requirement to wear face coverings in public spaces in public transport and in secondary schools remains absolute. I'm struck by the comments that were made yesterday by the chair of the British Medical Association Council, Dr. Chand Nagpal, who said, "It is vital that the government, the UK government, acts according to the data and takes a measured approach. Removing effective infection control measures like mask wearing on public transport and indoor crowded spaces will inevitably increase transmission, place the public at greater risk, especially for those who are vulnerable." These are very, very significant words of warning, and they are words that are taken seriously by the Scottish Government. I'll invite Professor Leach to address Mr. Fairley's second question, which relates to clinical advice.
We have enormous sympathy for those who are both anxious about vaccination itself and those who are anxious about their underlying condition making them anxious about vaccination, but neither are an appropriate exemption to not be clinically vaccinated. That's why we have systems in place to help with that. The first thing I would suggest those individuals do is speak to their care team if they have such a thing. If they have a disease that requires them to have a regular clinical team, they should speak to them. And then they should speak to a vaccinator. And we have tiered levels of vaccinators. So the first vaccinator you meet may well not be able to answer every question you have, but in every clinic, we have team leaders, we have trained individuals who can then talk you through. Nobody will force you to be vaccinated. Nobody will inject you without your consent. But the best place to have those conversations are inside your clinical team or in the vaccination centre.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to bring in, we've just got a little bit of time on our hands, and I'm bringing back Murdo Fraser, who's got a constituency question.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, I've got one question that's come to me from a constituent, and I wonder if Jason Leach probably is best placed to respond to it. And the situation this constituent is in is he has been double vaccinated and then caught COVID, so hasn't yet had a booster. And of course, under the vaccine certification scheme, he requires to get a booster. But the point he is making that is that having had COVID now, he would have natural immunity. And therefore, is it necessary for him to get a booster? And what's the science behind that requirement? I don't know if Jason Leach can help with that point.
Yep. I can. It is necessary for him to get his booster just as soon as he possibly can. We've discussed in this group before the nature of immunity. It's not a light switch. It's a dimmer switch. And both natural and vaccine immunity do slightly different things at slightly different times. So the more, the better. So you should absolutely get his booster just as fast as he can. We leave a gap principally to recover from symptoms, actually, just so people feel well enough to then have the vaccine and to be able to separate side effects, if there are any, which are rare and unusual, from the disease itself. So the advice to that individual is they should absolutely get the booster just as soon as they can, and it will do them good, not harm.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item, and I would like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for their evidence. Okay. Moving on to the second agenda item, which is consideration of the motion on the made affirmative instruments considered during the previous agenda item. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any further remarks on the SSIs listed under agenda item number 2 before we take the motions?
I think in the interest of time, convener, I'll not add any further points to the record.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Members content for the motions on the agenda to be moved en bloc. If you are not content, Murdo Fraser, can I bring you in, please?
Sorry, sorry to preempt you. I am content to move en bloc. I just wanted to make a point in relation to the SSI 475, because we have been advised that the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this on the 11th of January. Actually disagreed to this particular instrument on the grounds that they were dissatisfied with the made affirmative procedure. Now, I think we should simply note that, convener, as it happens, that the measures in this instrument are, of course, now historic, and on the basis of the announcements made earlier this week, are going to be removed as from next week. So I don't think there's any point as voting against it, but I think we should simply note the concerns of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser, and we'll note those concerns. So members are agreed to move all the motions on block. I now invite the Deputy First Minister to move on block motions S6M-02594, S6M-2602, S6M-02698, S6M-02699, S6M-02760, S6M-02733 and S6M-02799.
Moved on block, convener.
Thank you. Is there any other comments from members? I wish that no member has wished to speak, so I'll now put the questions on the motions. The question is that motions S6M-02594, S6M-02602, S6M-02698, S6M-02699, S6M-02760, S6M-02733 and S6M-02799 be agreed. Do members agree? If anybody doesn't agree, please put N in the chat. There's nothing in the chat, so the motions are agreed to. Thank you. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the statutory instruments considered at this meeting in due course. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Deputy First Minister. I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his supporting officials today for their attendance this morning. The committee's next meeting will be on the 27th of January, where we will consider the coronavirus discretionary compensation for self-isolation Scotland Bill at stage two. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. I suspend the meeting to allow witnesses to leave and for our meeting to move into the private session. Thank you.